I am really glad, and I'm not sure how much Caleb has had this morning, but whatever it is. Good stuff. So, a lot of good things going on. Just want to say good morning, and what a joy, what a blessing to wake up to that sunshine this morning. So incredible, isn't it? Just really good, good things. So, you heard about coffee shop conversations. It's an idea of the staff kind of came up with, and we're going to be talking about some of those things that perhaps are part of casual conversations at a coffee shop that we might engage in, and you'll hear a little more about that as we move into it today. I want to say thanks to the theme team. Didn't they do a great job just kind of emulating a coffee shop? Outstanding. And First Impressions team, the group that invites everyone to come in to worship and invites everyone to say hi to each other outside in the front area. You guys are aces. Way to go. Well done. And Chris and Steve, they help us with communion. And I just, again, thanks again for being so dedicated, Chris and Steve. Setting up communion for us. So, if anybody's interested in joining a team, whether it's the First Impressions team or other teams that we have here, just let one of the staff people know and we'll point you in the right direction, or we'll try to point you in the right direction and to somebody who you might be able to engage with. So let's begin with a word of prayer as we're thinking about this whole subject of coffee shop conversations. Lord Jesus, you are so good. You gave your life for us so that we could be free from the consequences of our sins. Lord, you blessed us so much, and we don't have words enough to be able to express our love and our joy for you and being with you. The security, Lord, that you give to us, the peace that comes. So today, we call on you to guide us in the way that we deal with the events of our everyday lives. Sometimes that maybe involves a conversation that we're having with somebody who we know or don't know. And we just ask, Lord, for your blessing over those conversations, over the people who we have been given by you to spend this life with. Bless us, Lord, to be people of prayer. We pray in your name. Amen. Okay, so coffee shop, just imagine the scene. You've made an appointment, or maybe you're just there because that's what you do. You go to a coffee shop, and maybe you're meeting a group of friends, or maybe you aren't meeting anybody. Maybe you're doing work from the coffee shop. Somebody comes up to you, or you have the occasion to sit by someone. You don't know them, or maybe you do. And all of a sudden, you need to be involved in conversation somehow. And as you are, you think about, what am I going to talk about? Well, coffee shop conversations. Hopefully, I'm not going to knock that over. Coffee shop conversations are those kinds of things that we think about and that we participate in kind of on an off-the-cuff basis. And as we're thinking through that, a lot of times what happens is you start to talk about the topics of the day. I want to share with you the place that's closest to our home that's kind of a coffee shop. It's where all the guys gather. It's Pete's Surplus. And if you can imagine a surplus store with a gas station and hunting supplies, a few groceries, that's where the guys gather. It's about 6-7 miles from our house. And so when you gather there, you hear about all these different kinds of things. And I don't have a chance to go over there very often, but when I do, boy, there's a plethora of discussions going on among these guys who are there. It's fishing, it's how thick is the ice, it's who got in an accident or who got a ticket last week. And all of the different kinds of things kind of rally around what's going on in the lives of these people. I know the owner of the store, his name's Troy. Troy Haverly, I don't know if you've run across that name before. He's one of the best skeet shooters in Minnesota, but he's really, really a personable guy. He knows me by name. He knows all those people by name in a bait shop, a surplus store. And so we start to think about the different kinds of stories that are affecting the lives of people. And it becomes the conversation in the coffee shop. By the way, Pete knows that I'm here today and I'm speaking to you about Pete's surplus. So he gave me permission to do that. We hear about these stories that are going on in the news, and believe it or not, a lot of these stories have some biblical implications. So just think about this. We've got the top story in the news, and has been for the last several months, and it has to do with what's going on over in the Middle East. And you get these images, instant images, on the news, you know, if you watch TV or if you read the paper or if you look at your mobile device. And so we get that. And the guys at Pete's, they probably don't go too much deeper than just the surface, just the pictures. But I know it's a conversation that they're having. There's the Trump trial, right, that's going on. That's another topic of conversation. There was an interesting story last week that they had the NFL draft? Anyway, so I was in there and just happened to hear the guys talking about, well, how do you think Minnesota did in their draft? And some of the guys said they did great, some of the guys said they didn't do great, and everybody had their opinion. So what was interesting, though, is one of the guys brought this up. He said, what did you think about the kid, the draftee, who said, all praise to God for his blessing me in this life to be able to be in this position? And I thought, that's really cool. They're talking about this in the coffee shop, in the gas station. And then I thought, you know, that's something that's real for us, isn't it? I mean, real for us in terms of speaking about our faith or being able to have those around us know that we are people who believe that Jesus is Savior. So I dug back into a few things that I have in my files, and I wanted to share these names with you. Tim Tebow, Dak Prescott, Kirk Cousins, and Clayton Kershaw. What do they all have in common? They're all Christians, yeah. And so in different kinds of ways, these guys, Tebow's a little bit older, and Prescott now playing, Cousins now playing for somebody else, Kershaw, a pitcher in the National League for the Dodgers. But you start to think about all these guys, and they've all been involved in making a public statement of their faith. So this person at the National Championship for Women's Basketball is the head coach of South Carolina and made a statement about her faith in the interview that followed the National Championship game. And then she made another statement, and I want to read it for you. She said, I'm not going to apologize for what I said or what I feel because I know my life and I know why things have happened in my life. And I'm going to salute God as much as I can because I know it's not just my doing. Dawn Staley. Now, why is that significant? Well, she's a public figure. She's somebody who has recruits from the high schools all over the country to come to her program to play basketball, potentially for the national championship. She has a platform and chooses to make a statement about her belief in Jesus Christ. And this is another piece of it. She's also criticized for that. I want to read a note for you from an attorney, Christopher Line. He's the attorney for Freedom From Religion Foundation. And so this is what he said. Staley, he wrote it to the president of the University of South Carolina. He said, Staley's ongoing promotion of her personal religious beliefs and her degeneration of non-Christians through the women's basketball program is a reason for dismissal. Current and future non-Christian and non-religious players should feel welcome and respected as part of the women's basketball team, not be told by their coach that they are on a team that is representing Jesus, and if you don't believe in God, something is wrong with you. On the firing line, isn't she? And I'd suggest that probably those other four guys that we talked about received some criticism for what they've said or what they've promoted in terms of faith in Jesus. So here's the bigger issue. It has to do with some of the things that we consider to be our rights as people. Are we able to make a statement of faith in public? As we believe, isn't that something that is guaranteed for us? Those kinds of deeper questions probably are not what's on the agenda of Pete's, those people at Pete's surplus store. But it is for us, it should be. I mean, as we're thinking about these statements that we make, the statements of belief that are part of our core as people, isn't that something that we want to be able to do freely and we want to be about, because that's what Christ calls us to do in Matthew 28. He says, go make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. What we just sang about. And if you think that through, that's a statement of faith. So, whether in public or in private, one of the keys that we get from Scripture, both Old and New Testament, is that we stand humble before God, regardless of the statement that we make. Also, statements that are made about God honor God as believers. And I think all five of these people would suggest that's absolutely true. In the Old Testament, that was critical for people to do. And then the third thing we're going to spend a little time with is self-examination. How does my life, whether it's in public or in private, how does that reflect what I believe about God? Maybe not in the words that I speak publicly. Maybe it's in the actions toward those who are closest to me, or for those who are in that sphere of relationships that God's blessed me to have. How do my actions, how does what I do in public reflect who Jesus Christ is in my life? Where's my heart? Would people who know me the best characterize me as having a heart that follows after Jesus? By what I say, by what I do, by how I pray, by my activities. So those are the things we're going to be spending some time on this morning. I want us to look at this parable. And you're going to say, well, Pharisee and publican, that's a parable about the prayer in the temple. And I want to show you why I think this is important. And the reason for it is simply this. At that time, in Jerusalem, the temple was a public space. The temple had places for women and had places for even those who were not believers, had places for men in their court, had places where the people who were the scribes would be teaching young people who were learning about this faith that they were involved with. And so this was a public place. And what Jesus does, because all of the people he's speaking with get what the temple is like, he talks about prayer. And this would be a public kind of prayer, a public statement, even though it might be personal. So he teaches about prayer, and he gives us a perspective of what it is that we know God desires of us in prayer. So here's the temple, and again, this place, especially when festivals were in town, and usually when Jesus is in town, when he's in Jerusalem, it's for a celebration of a festival. There were three festivals that were required for all the Jewish people to go back for. And that's when you hear about Jesus going up to Jerusalem in Scripture. Most of the time, it's because there was some kind of a celebrative festival that was going on tied to Judaism. And so most of the time, he lived up in Galilee, which is 70 miles north, and he did a lot of the ministry kinds of things that we have recorded in the Bible up in the Galilee, unless there was a festival where he was down in Jerusalem. I want to share this for you from Luke chapter 18, verses 9 to 14. So two men went up into the temple to pray, one a Pharisee, the other a tax collector. The Pharisee, standing by himself, prayed thus, "God, I thank you that I'm not like other men, extortioners, unjust adulterers, or even like this tax collector. I fast twice a week. I give tithes of all that I get." And that's all we have. And then the tax collector, who was standing further away, wouldn't even lift his eyes to heaven, but beat his breast, saying, "God, be merciful to me, a sinner." Those are the only recorded words we have of the tax collector. And Jesus said, "I tell you, this man went down to his house justified." He was talking of the tax collector, rather than the other one. "For everyone who exalts himself will be humbled, but the one who humbles himself will be exalted." Do you get what Jesus is teaching his disciples there? Yes, it's in the context of prayer. But even in a greater way, it's in the context of how do I stand as a person before God? Am I humble before God? Am I one who understands that God is my God? In prayer, am I one who addresses God as creator of the world, God who is almighty, God who is the one who gives me life? Do I understand that I'm a creation of his and that I owe all to him? Is my prayer life something that reflects that? And is not only my prayer life something that reflects that, but is my life? In the things that I do, the way that I live, does that reflect a humility before God? I want to share this with you for those of you who are married. Humbleness before God is reflected in the way that you walk with your partner. I'm going to say that again. Humbleness before God is reflected in the way that you live life or walk with your partner. And what I mean by that is that all of us, whatever roles we have in our marriages, in our families, whatever those roles are, need to understand that Christ calls us to humility, to servanthood, to being those people who want to reflect Him in our relationships. And if you can do that in your marriage, you will find that you will be blessed. And so as we start to kind of walk through this, we hear about this Pharisee, and we hear about how his prayer was focused entirely on himself. And the tax collector only says these few words, "God, be merciful to me, a sinner." I think about that, and I think, isn't that so needed for us in our society today? Because the reality is that our society, in so many ways, is a self-absorbed society, promoting self-absorbed ideals. You're great, you deserve it, right? How many times do we hear about people who echo the opinion that because of just who we are, we deserve all the good of life? And the publican says, "God, be merciful to me, a sinner." So humility in life. Humility in life is something that is so significant, and especially in the relationship that we have with our great good God, the creator of all things. He knows all the accolades we've done or had in our life. He doesn't need to hear them. What he does need to hear, what he desires to hear, is what's on our heart. In worship, we sang the song Praise before. You guys, way to go. Yeah. Heartfelt. As we lift our hands up in the air, if that's something that you feel like you want to do in praise, that's heartfelt. God desires our heart. He wants us to have that relationship with Him. And the other piece of this, we are absolutely in need, every single one of us, of the blood-bought forgiveness that Jesus alone can give. Humility before God understands that. Understands that we absolutely are in dire need of that forgiveness. So last week we talked a little bit about War Room, the movie, and Miss Clara and how she prayed. But it wasn't only how she prayed and that she was in her war room of prayer. It was how she lived out that prayer life in the things that she did day to day that were just a part of the way that she lived. A model for those in her life who needed to see Jesus. She would have been the first to say, "Well, I'm not Jesus." And all of us would say that. But the reality is, whether we're in a coffee shop or whether we're in some other kind of place, we are always those who can reflect Jesus Christ in who we are and what we do. So I want to take you to another psalm, and the psalm is Psalm 130. This psalm is a psalm that I think is so cool because as we think about this psalm, we think about words that are words similar to what the publican or the tax collector would have said, because it's really a psalm that is talking about crying out from our depths of our being before the Lord, humbling ourselves before the Lord. So Martin Luther said this, and I thought this was so cool, because he says, it is a proper master and doctor of Scripture, speaking of Psalm 130. In other words, in the contents of the psalm, it gives us perspective on the relationship between us and God. And there's another guy that I think is pretty cool to listen to. He writes this. It's a succinct but powerful expression of the theme that is at the heart of Scripture, the human predicament and its dependence on divine grace. Dependence on divine grace. Us. Each of us. The writer of the psalm gets that. It's a psalm of ascent. And that's why it's a public prayer. Because these people were praying this psalm as they were going up to Jerusalem for festivals. It wouldn't surprise me that Jesus would have been one of those praying that psalm when he was 12 years old, going up to the temple with his parents, Mary and Joseph. So we think about that. What I'd like for us to do is I'd like for us to pray this psalm. Now, when I'm saying that, I know we're going to be reading it, but through the words of the psalm, applying it to ourselves. Because what the focus of the psalm is this humility before the Lord and a prayer that just lays out one's heart before God. So let's read together. Out of the depths I cry to you, O Lord. O Lord, hear my voice. Let your ears be attentive to the voice of my pleas for mercy. If you, O Lord, should mark iniquities, O Lord, who could stand? But with you there is forgiveness, that you may be feared. I wait for the Lord. My soul waits, and in his word I hope. My soul waits for the Lord more than watchman for the morning, more than watchman for the morning. O Israel, hope in the Lord, for with the Lord there is steadfast love, and with him is plentiful redemption, and he will redeem Israel from all his iniquities. So as we think about those words, as we're praying those words, we hear words that are tied to our need for forgiveness. We hear words that are confessional words. We hear words and speak words that talk about God being in his place and we being in our place. And as we catch the focus of that prayer, it's praying that God would have mercy on us as the tax collector said, God, be merciful to me, a sinner. As we read that prayer, as we prayed that psalm together, that confession that we make, that we are in need of what only God can provide, his mercy, his grace, his strength, we confess to him that our sins can only be forgiven by him. And we need it, each one of us. As we think about coffee shop conversations, maybe we don't get around to confessing sins or that kind of thing, but what we do get around to is understanding that we're with people who need to understand merciful God, forgiving Savior. How can our life be a reflection of that? How can our life, as we live it, how can that statement of faith be something that's reflected in how we live each and every day? I want to share with you that I appreciate the people who have a platform in the news media that give credit to God and that he sustains them. And he has sustained them, and they would be praising his name because of that blessing that they have in their lives. I appreciate hearing that. So when Don Staley says something about that, I appreciate that. I think it is very cool. Don Staley said some other things that I don't appreciate, so you got to take that in context. When it comes to prayer, this is what I lean on. When it comes to praying in public, this is where I go. Don't be anxious about anything, but in everything, by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. And the peace of God, which passes all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Catch that focus? It's where it needs to be. It's on Jesus Christ, Savior. It's on rejoicing in God's presence. It's on understanding that God hears our every prayer. It's on being able to live that in the lives that he's given us to live. My dad used to have a saying, and the four of us boys will quote this statement when we gather as a family. Remember who you are and whose you are. Why? Because God's at the center of it. He's the whose you are. We want to live humbly. We want to honor our great good God in the lives that we lead, in the conversations that we have. Don't be afraid to talk about the things of faith in God wherever you're at, even in the coffee shop. And so as we think through what that means for us, we commit ourselves to our great good God and bless him, humbly approaching him in prayer and asking for his blessing over our lives. Amen.